There we go. Good morning and welcome to worship on this, the seventh Sunday of Easter. We're between the times of Ascension and Pentecost. We're glad you can all be with us today, the nine who have gathered in the sanctuary here, and those of you who are listening in on KIOW or live streaming on our service from our website. We're glad you can be with us and celebrate this Sunday and remember our veterans on this Memorial Day as well. We have a wonderful, besides the prelude, some musical tribute to our veterans, which will be our musical offering for today. I wish this sanctuary could be filled with people on this day and again next Sunday for Pentecost. I've been asked as a pastor, when are you going to open up the church? It happened to me just this week in the grocery store by a recent confirmant. He says, Pastor, when are you going to open the church? And it was a fair question because this is a guy who actually comes to church quite regularly. And my response to him and others has been, as soon as we can do so safely and we can have a plan we can all agree on. So we as a council met and are wrestling hard with this issue this past Thursday. And a motion was put forth to table the conversation about opening until we could figure out a plan. And that motion was defeated. There was a motion to open up the church building on June 13th and 14th. That too, there was discussions. I had reservations, to be honest, about that. And that was defeated with a split vote of 50 to 50. As a pastor, I can't vote, but I do have a say. And so what I have to say is the church hasn't closed. Wonderful ministry is happening and continues to happen, even when we can't meet in the sanctuary. In the next 2 weeks, we as a church will celebrate family confirmations of 11 of our confirmands, and again, I wish you could all be here. We had two last night, and the kids walked up to the pulpit and preached their faith statements, and it was beautiful. And they knelt here, and their family gathered around for the praying of wisdom and understanding for the Holy Spirit as they are confirmed. And it was very moving for those families. It was one posted last night, and within 2 hours, there were 87 responses to that post. So I know people are watching, and people are praying, and people are waiting for the opportunity to be in the sanctuary. And we will do so. As soon as we can figure out a plan that we can do so safely and in this time of a crisis as a result of this pandemic. But this is hard. Tuesday, we mourn the passing of Virginia Thomas, who for 25 years was a music minister in this congregation, led a Lutheran choir with Ginny and Ginny and Company. I've seen some of those recordings. They are equal to St. Olaf, Concordia, Luther choirs, the quality of that music. Virginia so deeply cared about this sanctuary. She fought hard when they put in carpets and said that was wrong. She spent 2 years planning her funeral to be here in this place. And so the family is deciding we have to wait until we can all safely meet here and honor her legacy here in the sanctuary, and so we will do so. What I do remember is this past summer when we celebrated the 100th anniversary of our building, she did come and speak for about an hour about the meaning of this space and this place. And if you want to remember Virginia in the coming weeks, you can go to our website, and she has recorded that, and you can see that. Also, we mourn the passing of Don Grothy, Wally Winden, and Don Amit, who died this past Thursday. His family are traveling from Alaska and Maryland to plan his services in the coming weeks, and they all are trying to do this. We are doing this together in the midst of this pandemic. What doesn't escape my notice as a pastor is that at the grave, I will have done three graveside services in the past 2 weeks, and the military has offered Otto Chose has provided their assistance with military honors at the graveside yesterday at the services for Wally Winden at Bristol Cemetery while standing in the rain. And so they will be doing so again in the coming week for Don Ammett. And they, if you read the papers, they will be doing that throughout tomorrow. And so this is how we cope with our loss and the memories of those who have gone before us. And we are church together in this place and all places. I want to just lift up a thanks that the radio broadcast this morning is given in loving memory of Russ Miley's 87th birthday, which is May 26th, from Sue, Brian, and Amy, Troy, and Aaliyah. Sue, thank you for that. She's helping us with the service today. So with that, let's take a moment to prepare for worship and then join in our singing of our opening hymn. Let me find that for you. Come, Gracious Spirit, Heavenly Dove, hymn number 404.
Gracious Spirit, Heavenly Dove, with light and comfort from above, come be our guardian and our guide, over every thought and step reside. The light of truth to us display, and make us know and choose your way. Plant holy fear in every heart, that we from God may ne'er depart. Lead us to Christ, the living. In holiness the road that we must take to dwell with God. Lead us to heaven that we may share fullness of joy forever there. Lead us to
hallelujah, Christ has risen.
Christ has risen indeed.
Hallelujah.
Joined to Christ in the waters of baptism, we are raised with him to new life. And so let us give thanks for the gift of baptism. We give you thanks, O God, for in the beginning you created us in your image and planted us in a well-watered garden. In the desert, you promised pools of water for the parched, and you gave us water from the rock. When we did not know the way, you sent the Good Shepherd to lead us to still waters. At the cross, you watered us from Jesus' wounded side, and on this day, you shower us again with the water of life. We praise you for your salvation through water, for the water in this font, and for the water everywhere. Bathe us in your forgiveness, grace, and love. Satisfy the thirsty, and give us the life that only you can give. To you be given honor and praise through Jesus Christ our Lord, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, now and forever.
Amen.
Kyrie eleison. Christe eleison.
glory to God, glory to God, glory to God in the highest. Glory to God, glory to God, and peace to God's people on earth.
Together, let us pray.
O God of glory, your Son, Jesus Christ, suffered for us and ascended to your right hand. Unite us with Christ and each other in suffering and in joy, that all the world may be drawn into your bountiful presence through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
Our first reading today comes from the book of Acts, the first chapter, verses 6 through 14. When the apostles had come together, they asked Jesus, "Lord, is this the time when you will restore the kingdom to Israel?" He replied, "It is not for you to know the times or periods that the Father has set by his own authority, but you will receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem, in all Judea and Samaria, and to the ends of the earth." When he had said this, as they were watching, he was lifted up, and a cloud took him out of their sight. While he was going and they were gazing up toward heaven, suddenly two men in white robes stood by them. They said, "Men of Galilee, why do you stand looking up toward heaven? This Jesus, who has been taken up from you into heaven, will come in the same way as you saw him go into heaven. Then they returned to Jerusalem from the mount called Olivet, which near Jerusalem is a Sabbath day's journey away. When they had entered the city, they went to the room upstairs where they were staying, Peter and John and James and Andrew, Philip and Thomas, Bartholomew and Matthew, James, son of Alphaeus, and Simon the Zealot, and Judas, son of James. All these were constantly devoting themselves to prayer, together with certain women, including Mary, the mother of Jesus, as well as his brothers. Word of God, word of life.
Thanks be to God.
Eyes of my heart, I want to see you. I want to see you. Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart. I want to see you. I want to see you. See you high lifted up. Shining the light of your glory, for I devour and know as we sing, holy, holy, holy. Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart. I want to see. I want to see you. Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart. I want to see you. I want to see you. See you high and lifted up, shining in the light of your glory. Out your power and love as we sing, holy, holy, holy. Lift it up, shining in the light of your glory. Pour out your power and love as we sing, holy, holy.
Our second reading is found in 1 Peter, the 4th chapter, verses 12 through 14, and the 5th chapter, verses 6 through 11. Beloved, do not be surprised at the fiery ordeal that is taking place among you to test you, as though something strange were happening to you. But rejoice insofar as you are sharing Christ's sufferings, so that you may also be glad and shout for joy when his glory is revealed. If you are reviled for the name of Christ, you are blessed, because the Spirit of glory, which is the Spirit of God, is resting on you. Humble yourselves, therefore, under the mighty hand of God, so that he may exalt you in due time. Cast all your anxiety on him, because he cares for you. Discipline yourselves, keep alert. Like a roaring lion, your adversary, the devil, prowls around looking for someone to devour. Resist him, steadfast in your faith, for you know that your brothers and sisters in all the world are undergoing the same kinds of suffering. And after you have suffered for a little while, the God of all grace, who has called you his eternal glory in Christ, will himself restore, support, strengthen, and establish you. To him be the power forever and ever. Amen.
Amen.
Word of God, word of life.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you, Ryan.
Alleluia, Lord, to whom shall we go? Alleluia, you have the words of eternity.
Gospel according to St. John, the 17th chapter.
Glory to you, O Lord.
After Jesus had spoken these words to his disciples, he looked up to heaven and said, Father, the hour has come. Glorify your Son, so that your Son may glorify you, since you have given him authority over all people to give eternal life to all to whom you have given him. And this is eternal life, that they may know you, the only true God, and Jesus Christ whom you have sent. I glorified you on earth by finishing the work that you gave me to do. So now, Father, glorify me in your own presence, with the glory that I had in your presence before the world existed. I have made your name known to those whom you gave me from the world. They were yours, and you gave them to me, and they have kept your word. Now they know that everything you have given me is from you, for the words that you gave to me I have given to them, and they have received them and know in truth that I came from you, and they have believed that you sent me. I am asking on their behalf. I am not asking on behalf of the world, but on behalf of those whom you gave me, because they are yours. All mine are yours, and yours are mine. And I have been glorified in them. And now I am no longer in the world, but they are in the world, and I am coming to you. So, Holy Father, protect them in your name that you have given me, so they may be one as we are one. The Gospel of our Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
Sisters and brothers, grace and peace to you from our God who was and is to come, Jesus Christ, lifted up into the heavens. Alleluia. We come to worship this morning on a Sunday sandwiched between the Ascension of our Lord, which was on Thursday, and Pentecost Sunday, which is next week. It's a Sunday we gather to worship God, as we remember how Jesus, after the resurrection, appeared on different occasions, risen from the dead to some of the disciples, including Mary Magdalene in the garden, two disciples on a road to Emmaus, to a group of disciples locked in an upper room without Thomas, and then a week later, again in the same room, this time with Thomas. And Thomas saw the risen Lord and came to believe. Also, as recorded in John, to seven disciples by the Sea of Tiberias, teaching them again how to fish. So this is just a little aside lesson. After the resurrection, some of the disciples, Peter among them, go back to their former vocation of fishing. And they fish all night and catch nothing. And then in the morning, they come in and meet the risen Christ standing on the shore. And Jesus again taught them how to fish differently, to try fishing from the other side of the boat. And when they went out again, they caught so many fish, they couldn't drag them all in. I think that's such a humorous story. What a wonderful ending to the Gospel of John. Here we are told was the third time that Jesus had appeared to them after he rose from the dead. And for some of these disciples, that was their first and last earthly encounter as Jesus came to them, said, come and follow, and taught them to fish in a different way, and then asked them to apply those lessons to the way they reach out to convert people to faith. How do we think about fishing for people differently? But the main point here is that between the resurrection and his ascension, Jesus has been pretty busy throughout these 40 days, checking in with his followers and convincing them that what he has said and what he has promised is true. So now, with the convincing truth about the resurrection and the ascension, we sit together, nine of us in this sanctuary, the Sunday before Pentecost, and wrestle with the question, what do we do now? What do we do next? How do we follow Jesus? How do we fish for people? We are living in fear, still a bit confused and uncertain about what we should do now. That's what we wrestle with on this seventh Sunday of Pentecost. And I think we have to be reminded that Jesus hasn't just taken up residence after the ascension and is now sitting in a throne up in heaven, not aware or caring about what is happening here on earth. Like those first disciples who are called and equipped to do more than just stand around and look up to the heavens and wonder, well, where is Jesus and what should we do now? It's time for us to think, where is Jesus here in the here and now? The introduction to our worship reminds us, it's printed in the bulletins, about these days between the ascension and Pentecost, where we gather with disciples in an upper room, waiting for the Spirit to transform the church and the world. And in today's gospel, Jesus prays for his disciples and for their mission in his name as we lead to Pentecost. We follow this story from the resurrection through the ascension to Pentecost and realize God is transferring God's power through the Holy Spirit to the church. And the church is being transformed. And so what will this Pentecostal transformation look like for our church today? Well, we don't talk about that much in Lutheran circles, about being Pentecostal. But perhaps we should. How is God living in us and being shown through us? Well, last week in my sermon, I mentioned how in baptism, Jesus calls us and claims us and names us. And then I went on to name all the seven who were gathered here in the sanctuary. And here's a personal confession. Last Sunday, as I mentioned, how Jesus still claims and calls and encourages us. This day, I went on to name everyone in the sanctuary except one, my wife, Nancy. And I felt bad about that all week. Others who caught it in the midst of the service kind of looked to Nancy and shrugged their shoulders and says, well, what about you? And Nancy was so gracious when I got home and throughout the week. And so, Nancy, Jesus loves you, and so do I. Maybe that's something when we've been all shut in with our significant others for so many weeks, it's important to remember and say that. Maybe we should think about how, as we share the peace during this time of social distancing, if you're at home, you might want to consider, what can we say to one another? What should we say? How can we find a new way of sharing the peace of Christ in an appropriate way, a safe way, rather than a handshake or a hug for those we want to care for? So Carolyn Lewis is a professor of biblical preaching from Luther Seminary and author of a commentary on the Gospel of John and a regular contributor to the weekly podcast Working Preacher. And this week, I listened to her podcast, and she reminded preachers how the gospel lesson for today, taken from John chapter 17, is from an extended prayer that is the whole of chapter 17, and it is often called the High Priestly Prayer. It's a section of the prayer that is appointed for the gospel reading in each of three successive years between Ascension and Pentecost. Now, the setting of this prayer is Jesus with his disciples praying to God, his Father, right before his betrayal and arrest, his trial and death on the cross. And so when Jesus in this prayer speaks of being glorified and lifted up, it's not first into the heavens, but lifted up on a cross. So that by his obedience and sheer will, sin and death will be defeated forever. And all people will understand what it means to be filled with grace for eternity. And this lifting up is also for the sake of the world. Dr. Lewis reminds us that the prayer Jesus prayed for his disciples can be divided into three sections. And that's how we hear this prayer as a gospel reading over the course of three successive years. And what we hear today in verses 1 through 11 are essentially a petition Jesus prayed to the Father on his own behalf. So Jesus looked up to the heavens and prayed for his own needs. Father, the hour has come. Glorify your Son so that the Son may glorify you. Jesus is asking for his God-given authority to be used wisely, for courage as he is lifted up, to give his life for all people so they too may experience eternal life. Allow me to finish my work, Jesus is praying, with the glory I had in your presence even before the world existed. And then in verse 6 through 17, the prayer moves to a petition for his disciples. Here Jesus prays on behalf of his disciples, not on behalf of the world, but the ones sitting in the room with him in that moment. Those who on this faithful night are listening to this prayer. Jesus prays to his Father in heaven, I will no longer be in this world, but Father, they will be here. So I ask you, Holy Father, to protect them in your name that you have given me so they may be one as we are one. His prayer is that we will follow now the Father and Son, and we will see that unity as something that binds us together as well. So finally, in those third verses between verses 20 and 23, Jesus prays for the world. Jesus prays for the world and those who will one day come to believe through their word. Whose word? The word of God is told by the disciples. So you see, our words, our actions, the way we treat one another, love one another, matters for the world. He prays, Righteous Father, the world does not know you, but I know you, and these with me right now, right here, know that you have sent me. And I have made your name known to them, and I will make it known, so that the love with which you have loved me may be in them and I in them. So if this unity with the Father and the Son unites us. That's what drives us to Pentecost. That's what equips the church to be that exceptional church that we will celebrate next week. So thank you, Dr. Lewis, for such a beautiful explanation of John chapter 17, the one known as the High Priestly Prayer. And then she goes on to say that in a time of crisis, this prayer, like the other of the Lord's prayers, can be used as a model for our own prayer life. Practically, she says, it's particularly important that you take time to pray for yourself, because Jesus did. Establishing a personal relationship with God and tending to it is a good spiritual discipline. So turn to God in prayer with your cares and concerns. And then take time to pray for those who are closest to you. That is important as well. Our individual personal relationship with God is not just an end in itself, but should bind us to the love and care of our brothers and sisters in Christ as well. So we are one as the Father and the Son is one. So God's glory can be revealed to who? To our neighbor. To the world. So as Jesus prays, all can come to believe through the proclamation of the word. So the world can see the glory of the Father and the Son through the unity and love of God we share with one another. This is eternal life. To live together in this unity, in this love, that is a reflection of the love and the relationship found in God and Jesus. And through the Holy Spirit, we are empowered for this work of love. And our calling is to be that reflection of that unity. So when and where does this eternal life begin? Well, now, when we respond to the giving of the Holy Spirit. Easter and Ascension has come, and Pentecost is on our way. The Holy Spirit is enlivening the church today as much as it always has, maybe in new ways, maybe in new languages. But I see wonderful expressions of the good news being expressed now, even in this time of crisis and social distancing, when Nancy and I take our morning and evening walks and I see the warm, faithful, encouraging words written on painted rocks throughout the town or on sidewalks along our paths. And our First Formation have just sent out their second craft package. And so you will see more sidewalk chalk art dedicated to the glory of God. That is the church today. Some say the church has been closed, while others are saying the church is being more creative and celebrating how the church can be by creative people who see the power of the Holy Spirit has already been deployed. It's out there in the world, sharing the good news, being born anew, being reformed, being resurrected. We don't wait for the church doors to be opened in person for worship. Believe me when I say I'm working hard and looking for the day that we can do that safely, that we can gather in this sanctuary. But don't wait. I'm not. Be the church today for your neighbor, for your neighborhood, for the world. Maybe that can be a part of our virtual offering and the sharing of peace in the coming week. Find a way before Pentecost Sunday to speak of God's mighty deeds of power in a new language, in a new way. Experience personal family worship of God in a new way. We normally ask everyone to wear red on Pentecost, but maybe this year you should just put red ribbons on your trees, post pictures of you and your family wearing red, your pets wearing red, Maybe we should just virtually paint the town red in preparation for church to again receive the promise of the Holy Spirit next Sunday on Pentecost. Christ has risen. Christ has ascended into heaven. Pentecost is on its way. Let's be the church today. Lifted by the promised hope of healing and resurrection, we join the people of God in all times and places in praying for the church, the world, and all who are in need.
O God, call your people to be one as you are one. Unite your church in the truth of your gospel and the love of our neighbor and the call to proclaim your reign to all people. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Breathe life into your creation. Guide your people as we explore the mysteries of the universe. We pray for the work of scientists and mathematicians whose skill enriches our understanding. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Make your justice known among the nations of the earth. Protect the vulnerable, especially among nations and peoples currently suffering from this COVID-19 crisis. Guide leaders as they make critical decisions, Lord. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Come to the aid of your children. We pray for those engulfed in grief, those without supportive families, and for all who are isolated, powerless, or afraid, that all may rest their anxieties in your care. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Give courage to all who embark on new ventures. We especially remember this day those who risk their lives to serve in our armed forces. Grant safety to those serving at home or abroad, and assure them of your never-failing strength. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Raise all your saints to eternal life. Until that day, we give you thanks for the faithful examples of those who have listened to your voice and now rest in you. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Lord, we pray for the families of Don Grothy, Wally Winden, and Don Ahmet, who served our nation well in their branches of military and now in their communities. And we mourn their loss and support their families. And for the family and community who mourn the loss of Virginia, who cared so much for her community and this church, we pray for them in these coming days. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
With bold confidence in your love, Almighty God, we place all for whom we pray into your eternal care through Christ our Lord.
Amen. Amen.
We pray as our Lord taught us. Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
As we think about how we can share peace in our places of worship and in our homes, in our community, and think of our offerings and gifts to God, we have an opportunity now for a musical tribute to all branches of the military service, presented by Ruth Sheldon.
Thank you.
We remember the many brave men and women who have given their lives to the history of our country to protect us from danger and harm. We remember those who sustained injury in mind and or body in the course of their service. And we salute all those who have served in the military. And so this blessing. May the Lord of glory bless us and keep us and our nation in his care. May Jesus, the Prince of Peace, rule in our nation and in our lives. May the Holy Spirit give us strength and courage to do battle against all the forces of evil. And may the blessings of Almighty God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be upon us and remain within us now and forever. Amen. Christ is risen just as he said. Go in peace. Share the good news. Alleluia.
Thanks be to God. Alleluia. Alleluia.